just going to say a little bit about like how this meeting came about. So I'm an independent researcher. I'm doing work on the East Coast war channels in the First World War, a piece of work for Historic England. And the war channels were it was a completely forgotten aspect of the First World War, but basically it was a channel that was made safe for merchant shipping. Being attacked mainly by U-boats laying mines and firing torpedoes and so on. And there's about 1,000 ships sunk on that coast, and it's within easy view of the coast. It's literally on the doorstep. So very organized system, huge numbers of losses, a really critical aspect of the First World War at sea, but you'll find virtually no reference to it. In the course of that work, as I said, there's over 1,000 shipwrecks. I'm not familiar with every single one of them, but looking for details of various of them, I came across this one. This is the Audax, which was torpedoed in September 1918 on the Yorkshire coast. It was an explosion. It was subsequently towed, and it sank while it was under tow. Three people killed on this. Guys, Mohammed, Gustav Johansson, Mohammed Abdul. These are the details that are in the Commonwealth War Graves database. And obviously we've got Asian seafarers, Swedish seafarer. One of the things that struck me when I looked at the records was the fellow born in Sweden is commemorated at Tower Hill in London, and the other two commemorated in Mumbai. And when you look at the plaque for the Audax in Tower Hill, only Gustav Johansson appears. And this struck me as odd, or bizarre for all sorts of reasons. And really up to that point, I hadn't really been aware of the fact that there were Black, Asian, minority ethnic seafarers involved in domestic coastwise shipping in the UK. I'd seen references in the oceanic trades, but not locally. This struck me as something actually really important to bring out as part of this work. Their last resting places, where these people died, with all three of those, they have no grave but the sea, as the phrase goes. So their last resting places, such as it is the wreck. The wreck still form part of our coastal landscape. This is Kettleness, where it was off Kettleness, where the ship eventually sank. As I say, their commemoration is distant, and it's divided, stroke divisive. There's no sense here of what was happening just off the coast of the people that died. Tower Hill is already a long way away. To be commemorated in Mumbai is even further away from where people were serving. And as I say, it's divisive. They're split apart by the way in which they were commemorated. And I was looking really for some context for these losses. I'm usually out of my depth in more or less everything that I do. So I pick bits and pieces together. So I'll go and find the book about it. And I couldn't find anything about the role of BAME seafarers in coastal trades and so on. And I contacted quite a few of you one way and another, looking for, do you know anything about this? Where do I find, where should I go? And it's really as a result of that I thought, well, perhaps we ought to try and get some people together and see if we can draw greater attention to this topic. There is information around. So this is the grave in Whitby of firemen Said and Hamid, who have lost on the Hercules. So they're referenced in the war graves. This is a war grave. So there is information, there is material remains associated with it in places which, this grave is by itself in a huge cemetery, and they're both in the one plot. You know, the treatment is different. I don't think many people visit that grave. And there are references in a few books. This is a kind of a fairly contemporary account referring to the Jamaican R&R. I couldn't find any other reference to the Jamaican R&R. The Royal Navy Reserve. This was in the caption on the back of the photo. It's in a book by Thomas Moat. It's about a black seaman who's been captured and is in the tower of a U-boat. Grimsby, there's an account by William Savory, who was a black fisherman in Grimsby, who went, I think, to Rutherburn. I don't think Mike, yeah. He was actually released early on a prisoner swap, but he gives an account of how he came to be taken prisoner and about his experiences of being a prisoner. And on the crew list and things like that, you can start to pick out indications of the diversity of seafaring. This is a ship that was sunk off Cromer, 1915, and Roberts there from the West Indies. So the crew list information, that's as well as these fragments, there are some sort of bigger sources of information arising from the catalogues of records. So the crew list data set, which you can is built from the crew lists. You can query that on birthplace, and that gives you a sense of the number. Now, this is crew times voyages for 1915, so it's multiples, but nonetheless gives you an indication of where people are coming from, some of the people are coming from. You can do something similar. I've just been looking at them, thanks to some help from the National Archives, provided with me a data set, which is the catalogue of BT351, which is the Register of Shipping and Seamen. Their index of mercantile marine mail. So these people who were able to... So the mercantile marine mail was a medal that you applied to after the war if you met the criteria for that medal, which was to have been in the merchant service, merchant marine, in a war zone. And the record cards, and hence the catalogues, include place of birth. So you can start to break that data down. It's a very big data set. In fact, it's so big that we couldn't look at it all. We had to kind of sample it. So we're working with a sample of 83% of the 157,000 people that were mentioned on it. And looked at the names they gave for where they were born, and again you can see some of the numbers, if you like, the scale of BAME seafaring involved in the mercantile marine. I'll just pop back a slide. You see on the crew list it says of the British Merchant Navy, 1915. I think one of the key things to remember is that really such a thing as the British Merchant Navy at that time. It's referred to as the mercantile marine. And it's not a service in any sense that we would recognise. It's just a collective way of referring to individuals who had individual contracts on individual vessels. Right? It's not a coherent service. It's just made up of lots and lots of private transactions. So, and that there was nothing about being British in that. It's referred to as British because those contracts are with British registered ships. It says nothing about the composition of that collectively mercantile marine. And it's hugely diverse. The people from literally all over the world, but in that there's clearly BAME seafarers represented. Not necessarily huge numbers, but certainly they're and diverse. And just so Aden, very important, Hong Kong, Goa, Calcutta, Jamaica, Europe, you can pick out places which are a lot of people are pointing to as their place of birth. I think these numbers might be under representations because, as I say, you had to apply for this medal. I don't know the degree to which people outside the UK were encouraged to apply. So I think that's, I don't think it's necessarily representative, but it is a set of information. Similarly, Commonwealth War Graves, not easy to crunch in terms of trying to find out what it might tell you about the people's origins. The this grand total, this is 15,000 people lost in the merchant navy of one form or another. So the one that's picked out is the Indian Merchant Service. It's looking increasingly like that's a post hoc rationalisation for people that they didn't want to put on the Tower Hill Memorial. So that I found no reference to the Indian Merchant Service as a thing. And you know, the people who were involved in this didn't know that they were part of the Indian Merchant Service until they were, you know, until you find that against their name, against their record of death, really. And the Mercantile Marine, that is encompassing, everyone else in a sense. So you can't really slice it down from the war graves data unless you were to go through looking at next of kin. In many cases, the next of kin for BAME, seafarers is not included. So there's the data is against you, but it gives you some sense of numbers. Similarly with the Royal Navy and the things that the Royal War Graves regard as Royal Navy, in a sense, there's a whole series of services there. Royal Indian Marine is picked out, but otherwise, if you were to try and find details of the Jamaican gentleman, or for example, he's probably in the Royal Naval Reserve. It says Jamaican RNR, Jamaican RNR doesn't appear here. So it's probably in the Royal Naval Reserve. And so that's where you'd have to try and slice in to try and find. It's very difficult to know how many BAME seafarers are in the naval services. Right, so just some thoughts really to set us off. So the absence of attention to BAME seafarers in the First World War. The first point is, it's not accidental, and in this I point particularly to some work, a paper that John Sibland, and John Sibland wasn't able to come today, he's working today. Not accidental. He's pretty convinced that as a matter of policy, the Imperial War Graves Commission, which is a precursor to the Commonwealth War Graves Commission, was effectively ensuring that the memorialisation of seafarers in the UK was white, and white only. And they effectively rationalised out non-white Europeans into Indian Merchant Service to be commemorated in Mumbai. Now, a lot of those people might have had only the slightest connection with India. A lot of them are probably from England, their heritage. Connections maybe somewhat distant from Mumbai, it has to be said, but nonetheless, they're all bundled off there. In Hong Kong, all the Chinese seafarers are lumped together and commemorated in Hong Kong. No relation to where they served, no relation to their what was going on. It seems to be an intentional move to effectively whitewash the commemoration of seafarers. So, not accidental. It's facilitated, I think, by this post-war rationalisation that appears to have gone. If someone can find the Indian Merchant Service and tell them all about it, then I'll retract. But so far, I've not found anything referring to the Indian Merchant Service other than the lists. It's not due to an absence of information. I've just flagged that already. There is information about BAME seafarers. It's available, you can find it. It does, however, I think, reflect an absence of seafarers of any background in narratives of World War I. The seafarers, despite the roles that they played, despite the losses, do not feature in many accounts of World War I at sea. You don't get seafarers' voices in the way that you get soldiers' voices. You know, you just don't. You might get, you get the ships and you get the admirals, but any sense of what the First World War meant, how it was experienced, in the same way as we have accounts of the trenches, for example, just don't get that. So seafarers of any background seem to be omitted. But I think there is a particular absence of the Mercantile Marine from narratives of the First World War, which again, those narratives, the dominant narratives, are very much about big ships and admirals. That absence in respect to seafarers, I think, contrasts with the recent attention to soldiers and labour corps, which has come about, which is, you know, obviously a very good thing. But it's not as if, in the course of the centenary, we have uncovered all the stories that have been omitted previously. And I think the key things can be reversed, and I think that's what I'd like to see, and why I'm really keen on this meeting happening. This can change. We can change that lack of attention. Okay, so just some initial considerations. These are almost things that I sort of try and remind myself. The role of the ME seafarers is not specific to the First World War. It has a really important pre-war element, a really important post-war element. And that, again, might make it a little bit different from how we think about the role of soldiers, BAME soldiers, which is much more, not bookended entirely, but is much more focused around the conduct of the war. What you're looking at when we look at BAME seafarers, particularly in the Mercantile Marine, is the continuity. It was happening in large numbers before, it happens after. There are specific aspects of the First World War, but it's part of a much bigger narrative. There's a very close connection between those seafarers and the development of onshore communities in the UK and elsewhere around the world. And that's really very important too. I'm keen also, which would pick up the port towns aspect, but I'm keen also to think about the seafaring aspect of it, what the experience at sea. And it is a question of individuals who faced extraordinary circumstances, not just of numbers. I've been putting some big numbers up, but, you know, essential to think, bear in mind quite what it meant to travel the seas of the world, expecting at any time for there to be an explosion which could either kill you or put you into the water, and all sorts of you know, horrendous things to then deal with. We hear about, if you like, post-traumatic stress in the shell shock kind of context. Don't hear very much about it being talked to seafarers. I've found a few references where they get really concerned about the effect on ship masters of actually being under this constant threat of exploding. But as I say, not very much about the experience of seafarers in that kind of perpetual state of anticipation. Importance to myself. It's not a single uniform narrative. There's huge diversity in the context and experiences amongst BAME seafarers. And I'll come back to this as an archaeologist. It's that I'm interested in, particularly in that material dimension. The places where these people lived and worked and sometimes died are still on the seabed. They're part of our landscape. They're often right on the doorstep. A few photographs of wrecks. They're still there. Just because we can't see them from the coast doesn't mean to say that they're not there. And some of the things that are happening with data and our capacity to see what's on the seabed, there is that opportunity to think of these not just as dots on a map now, but as literally as standing monuments to the war. And that's probably